Deep within the unexplored volcanic highlands of northern Sumatra, a wild river snakes its way through dense tropical jungle. Here, undisturbed rainforests form part of a narrow and shrinking equatorial belt that is home to nearly half of all types of life on Earth. The richest, oldest, most complex ecosystem on the planet, this Indonesian island jungle is a veritable catalog of rare and endangered species. For centuries, humans have been fascinated by the orangutan, the red ape of Southeast Asia. And in no place do these threatened creatures exist in greater concentration than along the wild Alas River. Join us on an adventure of a different kind, exploring unknown worlds on the first descent from source to sea of the River of the Red Ape. Tucked in the foothills of California's Sierra Nevada, Sobek International is an unusual travel agency headed by Richard Bangs. From childhood dreams of adventure grew Sobek, today a global network of guides and explorers.
Can you tell us this from Indonesia?
Yeah, I think
in Richard's ongoing search for new and wild places, he believes he's found something in a remote corner of Sumatra.
I think I've come across a river that looks pretty fascinating. It's called the Alas. It flows out of one of the high jungle regions. It's so remote, and there's so little known about it that it even doesn't appear on some maps.
With so little known of the Alas, Richard selects each member of the expedition with care. A skilled leader is critical to the survival of all. One name stands out.
That makes me think of Dave Shore. He led a lot of those trips over there in Papua New Guinea, and probably that kind of experience would be very valuable here.
Boy, Dave Shore would be fantastic. I would love to get Dave Shore. I can't think of anybody better, but I don't think he's available. Do you remember he announced his retirement 2 years ago after that accident in Chile?
Yeah, I remember.
Now he sells insurance.
The plan that I'd recommend here is called 90 Life.
2 years back, Dave settled in San Francisco, trading his life vest for a three-piece suit. But one call revives his passion for the wilds.
Another occupation at this point. I would love to have you with us.
I'm really ready to get out of here and do something like this, so this might be just the ticket.
Yeah, I'll tell you, Dave, we've had a lot of people work for us in remote regions of the world, but you've really been the best.
Come on, Sydney.
The next team member chosen must be a scientist with strong interest in Sumatra's rainforest. Primate biologist Dr. Michael Ghiglieri has done extensive research on the great apes of Africa and is an experienced river rafter as well.
My time on the river is going to be really limited, and I'd like to make the best use of it, get the most important data that I can in that period.
Third to join the team is Jill Botway, a former model, now a New York corporate attorney. Her studies of primitive tribal culture in Africa led to membership in the prestigious Explorers Club, but whitewater rafting is outside her experience.
Difficulty with deforestation there. I haven't been on an expedition in about 2 years, and my blood was starting to boil. The challenge of something new, absolutely.
Okay, now we're all set to go.
Forgot one.
This is the most important one.
Yeah.
Popcorn box.
The adventure begins 12,000 miles later in Medan, the capital city of North Sumatra. Indonesia is a world of cultural contrast, where Western-style commodities collide with traditions little changed since Marco Polo first landed here in 1292. Three centuries before Columbus discovered America, Islam came to the people of this vast tropical island. Despite 300 years of Dutch rule ending with independence in 1945, Indonesia is still a Muslim nation. Five times a day, the Islamic call to prayer echoes across the land, and the faithful bow deeply toward Mecca. Into this unfamiliar world, Dave and the others arrive in advance to buy supplies and load for the expedition.
Put those things to use. See this big...
As they search the local markets, it's obvious they are not just 12,000 miles, but several centuries away from home.
And lunches, let's just go with like dried fruit and nuts and... Up. Classic.
Finally, all is ready and waiting for the last member of the expedition to arrive.
She should be here by now.
What time you got?
5:15.
Last bus. You heard this term, jam parat?
Rubber time.
I think we just got to plan on her being late. No, she's supposed to be here.
I hope she makes it before dark.
God, I hope this chick knows what she is getting in for.
I hope we know what we're getting in for.
Here comes a bus, Michael. This ought to be it. Well, she comes with good credentials, so we'll see if she measures up.
The last bus.
Let's go out and meet her.
Go across here.
Let me put this thing down.
Hey, let me take it.
Hello, thank you.
You must be Jill.
Yes, and you are?
Michael.
Michael, nice to meet you.
Hi, Jill, I'm Dave.
Dave, nice to meet you.
It was a bus ride.
It was long and very hot. How long have you all been here?
Days.
A couple days right here. Welcome to Indonesia.
Fantastic. Thank you. It's beautiful.
Yeah, come on over and we'll get a beer and show you.
Great. You have quite an audience here.
Well, we've been doing some advance work for a couple of days, and I think what we found out is that how little everybody knows about the Aceh province and the Alas River.
Really?
Yeah, we got a map here. It's not very good, but it's the best one we could find. I'll spread it out. And we've drawn in the river. We've got a gorge here that, again...
Wow. A gorge?
Yeah.
You know, I've never been on a river in my life.
This is also the region where about 19 people have been eaten by tigers in the past few years.
Oh, that's reassuring. Thank you, Michael.
I knew you'd like that.
It is so thick.
It's pretty rugged
country.
That
is incredible.
Outside Maydan begins the vast primordial rainforest of Gunung Lesser National Park. This magical realm encompasses over 3,000 square miles and has been protected by legislation since 1981.
For a long time, it was stylish for the upper classes in Indonesia to have a pet orangutan. Mothers are killed and pets are sold. They're worth a lot of money.
Huh.
Problem is, they grow up.
Here we are, border of Gunung Lesser.
The Bohorok River. Good looking boat.
Across this gentle river, an unusual primate program is underway. It is a kind of halfway house for formerly captive or pet orangutans, now being reintroduced to the forest.
Bohorok Orangutan Rehabilitation Center.
Most orangutans brought to Bohorok are undernourished and diseased. To protect healthy forest animals, newcomers are isolated.
Hello.
Here at the center, Canadian volunteer Joanne Ranger, a wildlife biologist, manages the newly arrived orangutans, giving them the love and care needed to help them through the difficult transition back to jungle life. It was the Dutch, during their occupation of Sumatra, who started capturing baby orangs for pets. Since 1931, the practice has been illegal. Yet the trade in pet apes continues, primarily among wealthy Indonesians.
Presently, the Indonesian government is mostly in charge of confiscating the animals. A lot of the animals were donated by the owners themselves. When they get to about 6 or 7 years old, they're more trouble. They want to get rid of them, so they bring it to the center.
There was a lot of furor about orangs being shipped outside the country and being captured and held as pets.
The way to get a pet was usually they shoot the mother and then take the young one. And since they're way up high in the trees a lot of time, the young ones would die in the fall. So for one, you'd have two or three dying.
Where does your funding primarily come from here?
The station is now managed by the Indonesian government, and they haven't paid anything for the last month.
So oh my.
We haven't had any money for medicine, used up their budget for bananas and milk till next April.
Is that right?
Yeah. What's helping a lot is tourists staying here overnight, and that extra revenue is helping to keep the station going.
Bohorok has developed into a popular tourist attraction. On any given Sunday, as many as 200 visitors cross the river. Their entrance fees are critical to the continued operation of the center. Many have never seen an orangutan. All experience firsthand the magic of the forest and its inhabitants, and perhaps come to understand why this fragile ecosystem must be preserved.
How's life at the rehabilitation center? You don't have to answer. Do they feed you everything you'd like? Okay. You just won't tell us anything. All right. Try this paper. You know how to write? Did they teach you this? I'll show you how to do it. It's interesting. You should switch hands. Switch hands. Good, good. Oh. You're dropping the paper. You know, you'll be the envy of everybody if you know how to write your name. Give me the pen. Give me the pen. When these orangs start leaving the feeding area and go out on their own for good, is that a function of their age or an individual difference?
It's more due to the length of captivity, how long they were in captivity, or what age they were caught. If they've had some experience in the forest before, then they tend to be faster to rehabilitate.
How long might one of these stay here before they break away, if they break away?
They eventually break away, but they're all different. Some within 2-3 months are gone, 6 months. Others have been here for almost 3-4 years now. Benny.
Today is Benny's big day. After 5 months at Bohorok, she is ready for release. Benny will be taken to a feeding platform deep in the jungle. There, park rangers bring milk and bananas twice a day in decreasing quantities as the domesticated orangs grow less and less dependent upon people for their survival. Benny has grown attached to Joanne. It is a journey she is not sure she wants to make. Sometimes it takes several attempts for an orangutan to readapt to the jungle. Another orang, Susie, is making her third trip to the platform. Each time she has found her way back to the security of her cage.
Thank you.
soda.
Aren't you hungry?
Come on. I think she's just been so long with humans. She's got the idea she's not an orangutan, she's a person. She's very brave in the cage, but of course she's terrified here right now. Mm-hmm. Good girl.
It's like her first day at preschool.
She doesn't want to yet. Turun, kosumatrum baru ambil dia ke tempat. Hey.
Well, psychologically, these apes are half human and half ape, and they're not sure where they are. So, they're having trouble entering into the real world.
Eh, kita naik. Ayo, Benny. She's not gonna go, so can we still back out, sorry.
Finally, Benny is left alone, caught between the desperate worlds of human and ape, one of just a few thousand remaining orangutans hanging on the edge of extinction. Leaving Boharak, the expedition sets out on a hard two-day drive through the rugged central mountains to the headwaters of the Alas River. The goal of the expedition is to descend the river from source to sea as it spills through the unexplored jungles of Gunung Leser, 199 miles to the Indian Ocean. Midway through the journey, they hope to spend several days at the Katambe Primate Research Center, where Michael can continue his studies. Any tribal communities and peoples encountered will be the focal point of Jill's research. Since this will be a first descent, Dave looks forward to the thrill of running rapids never before run and turning unknown corners. At the tiny village of Agusan, the Americans rendezvous with an Italian rafting team led by the veteran explorer Jacopo Maisi.
That's our question.
Have you guys seen this down here? Where's the rain?
Well, it's due here about 3 weeks ago.
Doing great things for my suntan, but I don't know about it. It's awfully skinny down there.
Yeah, well, we got some major decisions to make. If we want to run this thing from here or walk it. Well, what do you think?
Looks low.
Looks low.
Yeah. Looks too low.
Not enough to float.
We need 1 meter more.
Yeah.
I don't know how we can go down here.
What about running one paddle bar?
Down here?
I would like to try.
Carrying nothing.
A low river means many exposed rocks. The danger is great, and passage will be difficult, if not impossible. Only veteran river runners will make this attempt. The less experienced, including Jill, must pack their gear overland and join the rafts farther downstream. The hard decisions ultimately rest with Dave, the expedition leader.
What's all this?
This is what I'm going to take to the river.
No, it's not.
What do you mean?
we got to pare this down a little bit.
Can you get rid of one of the pair of boots?
No, because if those get wet, then I have to have something dry. These are going to be wet, right, all the time?
We don't have to worry about them getting wet. They're definitely going to get wet.
No, but if we go hiking, these aren't good hiking boots.
Wear another pair of socks.
How about my books?
Leave them here. Well, they're just going to get mildewed and wrecked on the trip, I think.
But how am I going to get my information?
Okay, one book.
Oh, come on, Dave. You're a mean man.
Hey, this is the tropics.
What's this?
That's my rope, so that when all my clothes get wet, I can hang things up. I've got clothespins, too.
You don't need to put those down there.
Oh, come on, Dave. These things dry everything. Right, you're going to be able
don't
to wear a
don't use these emotional appeals on me, okay?
You probably won't even use half the stuff that's in here.
I have a hard time believing that.
Mm.
At dawn, under the curious gaze of the Agassan villagers, the expedition at last gets underway. Bound for the Indian Ocean, an unknown number of weeks and days downstream on the River of the Red Ape.
Finally, we're off. All right, let's go.
We're all adrenaline addicts. I think that pretty much goes without saying. But also, you just don't know exactly what you're going to find. You're just forced to be aware. You just open your eyes more on adventure into the unknown.
Center! Left! Forward! Stop! Back paddle!
Because this is a true exploratory, nobody knows what lies downstream. The crew must stop and scout from land whenever serious rapids are encountered. If a route can be found through the rocks and whitewater, the rapid is run. If not, the crew lines the rafts through the turbulence.
You see, there's one rock that's half wet. It's got a little dry spot facing that way. We're going to try to cut from here above that one.
Creative rafting. No such thing as a clean run. Huh? And no rules. I like that.
Light one.
The challenges of running the Alas at low water demand the crew use its full arsenal of sophisticated river running techniques. Downstream, the character of the river changes again. It gets steeper, faster, more dangerous.
Get up there, top of the tube. Get up the lower side. High side. Watch your footing.
Suddenly, too suddenly, a rap. The boatman's nightmare. The raft washes against a rock sideways, and the force of the current folds the boat around it. Thousands of gallons of water press the boat against the rock, multiplying its weight by tons. Step up. Some boats stay stuck in a rack for hours, some for days, some never come loose. An hour passes, then another. They try every trick they can think of to dislodge the boat.
I'll take over when you get tired, George.
On a jungle canyon river like the Alas, a long-term rap can have serious consequences. A bivouac, or perhaps the end of the expedition. At last, the Italian boat comes to the rescue. An accident such as this requires teamwork and helps bond the crews from two countries. The added Italian muscle on the ropes begins to make a difference.
Woo-hoo! All right, what a way!
A day later, the rafting crew reunites with the rest of the expedition. For Jill Botway, the adventure is just beginning. For Dave Shore, every rapid is a painful reminder of an earlier time.
Since rafting seems to offer everything there is and a fantastic lifestyle, I don't understand why you would leave it.
I don't know, I was a boatman for parts of 12 years. You know, I did it in the spring and the summer through school, and when I finished school, I did it full-time for Sobek around the world. And I used to work 3 months in New Guinea, and then 3 months in Chile, and 3 months in North America. And, you know, I was 29. I wasn't really so worried about being old. But, and also the last year on the river, we had some bad accidents.
Like what?
Well, occasionally you make mistakes, and we made a mistake. We went into this rapid, and we turned the boat over.
Mm.
And we had seven people, mm-hmm. and six of them got to shore, and yeah. one didn't. And it was this guy, and, you know, we were all set up. We had done everything right, in a sense. We had throw bags that landed 2 feet from him. We chased him down the next rapid with a boat.
Mm-hmm.
But he got away from us, and we couldn't catch him. So he ended up drowning in that rapid.
Ugh.
By the time he got to the bottom of the rapid, he was just a lifeless blue form held together by a life jacket. And everyone in camp went through a bout of crying, you know, and being real sad and kind of getting through it. And I had so much to do just keeping the trip together that I never went through that grieving stage. I was just strung up like tight as a drum. And going home, I finally just let go. I just broke down and I sobbed for an hour and a half in this little bus station in Chile. And it just was, I never felt so completely purged.
Pull over and ask some of these locals about that gorge up ahead.
The native Gayu people have long crossed parts of the Alas for trade. Their help is solicited in foretelling dangers ahead.
On the river.
Mulai dari sana ke bawah terjun begini.
Straight down.
Batu besar.
Down here.
Sana terjun.
Uh-oh. Sounds ominous.
You know, another thing we got to worry about too is there's trees. You know, remember upstream how close the trees were to the river. We could be going through vines and have no way to pull over.
Speed up when it narrows down.
Jill, there's only five commands you need to know. Forward, back paddle, stop, don't do anything. Right turn and left turn. You're on the left side of the boat. Left turn! So when we say left turn, you paddle backwards, perfect. And put it on your hip and crank it that way to do it. So everybody back paddle. Left turn! Stop.
if we do a right turn, you paddle forward. Okay, let's do a, hold on a sec. Left turn. Stop. Boy, that is a steep and narrow gorge.
That can hold anything.
Barely looks like it holds a river, though.
What's it drop, 150 feet a mile?
I think that's the section where it does. Look at how wide it is up here, and then it just narrows down to nothing down there. I feel like Powell going into the Grand Canyon.
What's that quote? Unknown river yet to run, unknown dangers yet to face.
Left turn. Hey, what's it like when we get to the rough part? Turn forward. Hey. Forward. Fine. Watch out! Ah! Mike, you okay? Mike's been hurt. Let's get over.
Turn this way.
A barbed vine has raked Michael's face, leaving several large thorns embedded just under his eye.
You're lucky, Michael. You could have lost an eye here.
Can I have another alcohol swab?
With time pressure mounting, the river casts an unrunnable section of waterfalls. Dave makes the decision to line the boats.
This rapid is a series of problems. Maneuvers, drops, waves, holes. Probably 10 years ago we would have run it. And 10 years ago we were still killing people. So, probably a good thing that we didn't.
You got a stump here.
Gotta come back this way.
Nightfall approaches, one last rapid looms downstream. The crew decides to go for it, to run the rapid without even scouting. At last, after four adrenaline-packed days in the upper gorge, the boats pull into a back eddy at Katambe Primate Research Center.
It was the most beautiful trip of my life.
All right.
Thank you, Dave.
All right.
The next day, the Italians decide time pressure will not allow them to wait for Michael's research. They must continue downstream.
They're too polished now. They're no fun to watch.
The dance of a thousand hands tells the story of how Islam was introduced into Indonesia in the 12th century. Rarely performed, it is a special honor for the expedition. Originally a rehabilitation center for orangutans, much like Bahorik, Katambe now serves as a research station for primates and other mammals. For over 10 years, this spot has been the chief field study station in all Asia for not only orangutans, but lesser apes such as gibbons, leaf monkeys, and long-tailed macaques. For Michael Ghiglieri, this stop will be the highlight of his trip.
Hi.
Hello.
You must be from the Sobek.
Yeah, I am. Michael Ghiglieri.
Yeah, my wife, Michael.
How do you do?
Michael.
Oh, I'm glad to meet you.
Well, anyway, welcome to Katamba Station.
Thank you. It's been a long dream of mine to arrive here.
So you're a primatologist?
Yes. In fact, I did most of my work in Africa on chimps and gorillas.
And you're the first primatologist who has visited us.
That's right.
So you're quite welcome.
You're pretty isolated here then. And I understand you're studying the behavior of long-tailed macaques?
Yes, that's right.
The local people just cannot imagine that we are watching monkeys here. They think we're looking for gold.
The animals have been studied since 1972. As a matter of fact, I think this one is one that originates from rehabilitation.
That's the daughter?
Yes.
This female's a successful experiment because she's produced two offspring who are wild.
Yes, that's certainly true. She's a very successful rehabilitator.
A graduate. Tropical rainforest is the culmination of millions of years of evolution. It's the masterpiece of evolution. Of all the habitats and groups of organisms that live on Earth, more than half the species are found in the tropical rainforest. The Indonesian tropical rainforest are the most complex of all. So in essence, this is the most important place on Earth from a biologist's point of view. Species, orangutan. Location, southwest quadrant, 17 meters above the ground. Unlike chimpanzees and gorillas, orangutans are asocial. They travel individually and rarely nest down with anyone else. This creates a problem in finding them because there's no group to make noise and no group to locate by their noise. So in order to pick up observations early in the morning, an observer has to camp right underneath the tree where they're sleeping. This means going to sleep with them at night and waking up with them in the morning and just following their routine. This makes for a long camp out because in the tropics, the nights last for almost 12 hours. So unless you're very sleepy, you spend a lot of time listening to jungle sounds. The life of an orangutan revolves around eating. It's the focal point of their existence. Scientifically, we say they're frugivorous. But beyond fruit, they also strip a lot of bark and eat leaves and occasionally go after insects. But the pivotal aspect of their environment is fruit and fruit trees. So from the orangutan's point of view, Gunung Lesser National Park is the place to be.
What are you complaining about?
Complaining? How cold do you think it was last night, Dave?
78, 80.
78. Try more around 50 or so. Don't you think it would have been nice to have a sleeping bag?
Were you cold?
Was I cold? Oh, and remember
I was perfectly
that?
Warm.
I'm glad you were. I would have been freezing if I hadn't snuck my towel in there to roll up in overnight.
Oh, gee, I'm really sorry, Jill. I thought you'd be warm enough up here in the tropics.
Yes,
you
I
know.
You
right on the equator.
Sure. And remember that foolish clothesline? Perhaps we could have dried something out like this wet sarong.
This wouldn't dry out. Even if you had a clothesline, it wouldn't dry out.
Oh, you don't think so?
But here, you can use the top of the tent.
The top of the tent is soaking,
look
too.
Look, my towel got dry last night.
Right. That's great.
The forest is really sucking up the water.
This rain now is what I was expecting the whole trip, this being the rainy season. I expect we have some time before the ground gets saturated and, right. And the river would start coming up. I hope it's at least till tomorrow morning.
Right, so some reason, most of the rain falls at night. It's a very civilized rain.
With the all-night rain, the river swells to near flood level, which could mean trouble in the downstream rapids.
Sure, hey, how many of these French toast can you eat, George?
No, I'm not saying.
The next morning, the threat is lifted. For a time, at least, the coming monsoon refrains.
Okay, last call on French toast. Salam alaikum.
With little resemblance to its younger, feistier upstream self, the river now winds fat and middle-aged through a populated central valley. Here along the middle Alas, the people eke out an existence that has changed little over the centuries. Theirs is a simple economy of farming, fishing, and trade.
The women in West Sumatra are the prime focus of attention and are incredibly respected. We stopped at a village where we sat under the remarkably cool shade of a thatched roof. The locals made us tea and fried bananas. One woman there, who looked quite old, told me she was 35 and has 10 children. She then showed me how to roll a betel nut to chew. First she took two green leaves, then spread some white paste around, then crushed up part of the nut into a powdery form and put the rest of the nut in the middle of the leaves. She rolled the whole thing up and jammed it in her cheek.
Makan.
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 Then she took some tobacco and rubbed her teeth with it to clean them. Her teeth were all silver. She'd had them made in Kutuchani a few years ago.
Ah. Oh. Bagus?
It was only 25 years ago the Pakpak were considered the headhunters of Sumatra, and to come from cannibals to wearing Chips t-shirts and Snoopy shorts astounds me. That would be an interesting study in itself, to see how and why the Western influences come in so quickly.
I can't believe how this river has grown in just a few miles. I've never seen a river swell in volume exponentially like this one has. This is enormous.
Aren't we coming up to a gorge down here someplace, Rich?
At some point, there's a limestone gorge, and the river cuts through the middle of it. We have yet to meet anybody who's floated this river. So it's a complete unknown as to what this gorge has to offer.
With little warning, the river accelerates, penetrating the steep-walled silence of the lower gorge. In stark contrast to the busy villages of the Central Valley, the gorge is peaceful, idyllic, isolated. The group easily falls under its intoxicating spell. They have floated into Eden.
It's so funny, we come from a society that's so punctual and so time conscious, and everybody knows within a couple of minutes what time it is. They're very well aware of it. And here, no one's that concerned about it. Today, tomorrow, an hour, 3 hours, it all blends together. Okay, now ask them how far it is from here to Gelombang.
Kira-kira berapa jauhnya, Pak, dari sini ke Gelombang?
2 jam lah.
2 hours.
One of the first concepts we learned about here was jam karat, rubber time.
Kami berayun, berdayung.
Oh, kira-kira jam 3 nanti sudah sampai dari sini.
Another 6 hours.
6 hours to kill them, bang. It couldn't. Sort of like the concept of mañana, except I think it's a lot more elastic than that even.
Yeah. It's about 4 hours.
4 hours by little canoe.
Little canoe, but they move very fast.
Could be 7 hours.
Let's see, last night the guy told us it was 4 hours to Gelombang.
Yep.
Today at noon the guy told us it was 6.
Seven.
You know, this ought to give us some gauge of the distance here. We've been getting such different stories.
Near the end of the lower gorge, the river rears and spits its biggest rapids. Now the Explorers Club flag, symbolic of man's quest for knowledge and adventure, is raised in anticipation of the final rapids ahead.
Here we go.
good help is really getting hard to find. Ghiglieri hasn't paddled here for an hour and a half, you know. How does he expect to be able to get downstream and do his studies?
You got the two clubs.
Dr. Giggs, who played the two?
I did. There's a tributary that's the one that marks the park boundary.
Yeah, I think it is.
Yeah, I think things are going to be a little different from here on down. We'll probably start to have access to the river and people living along the banks.
Machine is like some mechanical dragon, the enemy of the forest. On a worldwide scale, every year, 50,000 square kilometers of rainforest is cut down. At this rate, which shows no sign of decreasing, all the world's tropical rainforest will essentially be gone in one generation.
Just within our view here, look, there's four slash and burns just right here along the riverbank.
Yeah, look at that big cut downstream on the left there.
The logging concessions in Indonesia are cutting down forest faster than any other place in the world. Have another peanut. And in one sense, if it were not here at all, I'd say in 20 years there would be no possibility of having a park because it probably would be logged out.
It seems like an elitist concept here is what I'm saying, to have a park carved out to protect, you know, the World Wildlife Fund, the paper that I read, they're setting it up to protect the rhinos and the orangs. Seems like it's much bigger than it needs to be. Why have such a big park for a few animals when you've got all these people to worry about? The kids are uneducated, there's tropical ulcers all over them. And, you know, right in their backyard, we're forming this big park.
It's much better for everyone else concerned that there is a national park because the goods and services the park offers that could list for a long time, just the watershed, allowing the river to come down clean and not wildly oscillate during the seasons, preventing erosion, having the cropland down here be fertile. It's now known that tropical rainforests are in fact a cause of certain weather patterns. To remove the timber on this area would drastically change the climate, would change the rain patterns that people rely on down here for their crops. It's averting disaster for the people who live around the park, particularly downstream. Downstream there would be a big price to pay.
That's a good point. I mean, I guess looking at it that way, saving orangs and rhino and tiger is really just a side benefit to preserving the system as a whole.
أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ.
At Gelumbang, the river passes into old age. It slows and bends and leaves behind its fire. Here the whitewater rafts can be stowed and a motor launch hired for the final push to the sea.
On a river trip, you take people through a whole range of experience and emotion. They're comfortable, they're uncomfortable, they're wet, they're cold, they're tired, they're happy, they're hot, they're excited, they're thrilled, they're scared, it's everything. What I liked best about river trips was the people.
All right, try that.
The team feels especially close, having faced together the Alas, sharing its secrets and trials. And yet, as the expedition nears its conclusion, thoughts naturally begin to turn toward home. For Dave, Michael, Jill, and the others, the expedition has been a chance to see and feel what has been called the finest celebration of nature ever known on this planet. It was a journey through time, from the million-year-old rainforest of the orangutan into the pre-industrial valleys of family tribal life and back to the civilization the crew calls home. Which era, which life is better, as it completes its own endless pilgrimage to the sea, the Alas passes no judgment. Only hope for future life and eras along the river of the Red Ape.